A very warm good evening to one and all present over here. You are invited to attend a talk on Academic Capitalism in the 21st Century by Dr. Sridhar Tayur, four distinguished research chair professor of operations management, Carnegie Mellon University, right in this evening. Sridhar Tayur is the fourth distinguished research chair and professor of operations management at Carnegie Mellon University's Tepper School of Business. He received his Ph.D. in operations research and industrial engineering from Cornell University and his UG degree in mechanical engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology at Madras. He has held visiting positions at MIT and Cornell. He is the founder of the software company SmartOps Corporation, which was acquired by SAP in 2013 and served as its CEO for 12 years. He was also the founder of a hybrid social enterprise, OrganJet Corporation. He has published extensively in operations research, management science, mathematics of operations research, mathematical programming, and a lot. He is also the co-editor of the widely referenced book, Quantitative Models for Supply Chain Management. Dr. Tayur also served as president of Manufacturing and Services Operations Management Society. He has won the Undergraduate Teaching Award, the George Leland-backed Teaching Award given by MBA students, the Informs Teaching Case Award, and has been named as a top professor by the Business Week. Over the past 24 years, he has also been a sought-after supply chain consultant and has helped implement manufacturing and supply chain optimization systems for Caterpillar, Deere, General Electric, as well as implement solutions in other areas such as fractional jet scheduling and advertisements and internet games for Microsoft. We are very glad to have you here, sir. We would be pleased to listen to you.
Are we good? Okay, my pleasure. All right, thank you for the invitation. I look forward to interactive talk. I have lots of slides, so we can go through some of them faster than others. I thought I'll first give a few slides which is a philosophical overview of life. I know some of you are too young to think about that. Let me see, how many of you were born before June 1986? Okay, not many of you. I left in June 1986 and this is my first time back. And so many of you were not conceived when I was last here. So when I met Dean Nagarajan and the Dairo Bhaskar last summer at CMU, I expressed some concern about coming back to IIT Madras because I had become very different from where I was. I told them, you know, I was a very straight and narrow guy. I did my homework. I was a 10-pointer. I wrote GRE. I got 800. I wrote AGRE. I got 990. I went to get a PhD. I got straight A's. I'm a vegetarian. I smoked only once, you know. So I was exactly the kind of person that every mother would like, but no daughter would like, you know. right? But I was chugging along. And then I got my PhD. I became a professor. I decided, you know, don't move out from this, you know, safe and narrow track. But then along the way, I started thinking. So I thought I would show you some slides about what are some of those thoughts that have taken me away from a very straight and narrow kid, you know, to something else. So some preliminaries. I want to talk a little bit about my software company. For those interested in supply chain and operations research, I want to show what I commercialized and then the company that SAP bought. And I was the CEO for 12 years, so I built it from scratch, and we created this space called Enterprise Inventory Optimization, EIO. I want to spend a little bit of time on what I consider mainstream capitalism. This is how people with money make more money. This is private equity. You buy companies low, you turn them around, you sell them high. So I want to show a few examples of what MBA students who become very rich do to become rich. I had some fun working for a startup called Massive Incorporated. This was acquired by Microsoft when Satya was the head of Xbox division. So I'll show you the business model and I'll show you approximately what we did there. Since selling SmartOps, I've decided to concentrate much more of my efforts in social enterprises. I'm investing in some startups and I've been trying to see if I could do things that are not only commercial in nature. To that end, OrganJet is one of my more recent starts, so depending on the time, I'll spend a few minutes on that and then we'll close it. Okay? We good? I'll let you read this for a second. So who do you think said it and when did he say it? So I heard of Bertrand Russell. His co-author was Alfred North Whitehead, and this is a quote from Whitehead. So during Cambridge 1920s, 1930s, people were asking, what is the role of the university? And of course, there are many roles of universities, but I thought this was a good snapshot to keep. So you're young, you're imaginative, maybe you don't have too much experience. I hope I still have some imagination left. And then some combination of imagination and experience will create a better future. Okay, so that's kind of the view. And I've been a professor at CMU. This is the end of my 25th year. Okay. So lots of things have changed. The word entrepreneur was never used in India when I was here. Okay, it never existed in the vocabulary. In fact, it wasn't even very much used in the United States. And entrepreneurs were typically treated as those people who were not good in studies. If you were not good in studies, you are not employable, you didn't were not disciplined, you were somebody that couldn't fit into society, you had to go do something on your own, so you were the entrepreneur, you were the rogue. It was a bad word. You started a restaurant, you tried to do some import-export business, generally shady, right? And people didn't want to be associated. What actually happened in the 80s, at least in the US, late 80s, early 90s, is some of the technology entrepreneurs started becoming wealthy and getting into mainstream social, let's say framework. But to me, it was 1995, 1996 when this thingy called internet came along. Obviously, many of you were born after that, so you probably don't know that there was a time before cell phones, there was a time before Google, there was a time before internet. Some of us sent out the first emails. When I was at Bell Labs in 1988, the first cell phone was there. If you've seen Wall Street movie with Michael Douglas way back, he was carrying around this big thing. I had that. It was the first cell phone, and when I took it out of the office, everybody was jumping on me to say, show me the cell phone. Right? It was 88 cell phone. By about 95, 96, Netscape was on. I built my first student homework on Netscape, and people said, what are you doing? And I said, no, there's something called a browser. It was all new. Server-side computing was new. Right? What has changed in the last 20 years, if you think about 1995 as maybe a defining moment into 2015, is that entrepreneurship has taken on a distinctly intellectual. The better you are at math, the better you are at computer science, the more successful entrepreneur you are going to be in today's time. It is almost like what used to be exactly wrong for entrepreneurship has become exactly right. So suddenly, people want you to be very good in math and computer. They want you to get the A plus. They want you to win the math Olympiad, right? So suddenly, the world has changed. And so I've been so kind of lucky that it came about the time when I was not too old, but I was not too young. Okay. So I want to go through some examples of things over time. As you know, the big thing now is platforms. Everybody wants to build a platform. Uber being one of them, and Airbnb. So I created this on Mac, projecting here. It's a bit more squished, but I thought I'll put two worlds and try to give you this Venn diagram. Right? So on the left side, you're going to see a bunch of words that may or may not make sense to you, but this is the mathematics of operations research. So some of us liked operations research for two reasons. One, it was mathematical. There was something cleanly about it. And depending on how mathematical you were, you went towards math of OR, which means you did graph theory and things of that type. Or if you were very practical, you did something called computational integer programming and helped airlines schedule planes better and so on. But it was always a branch of applied mathematics. Okay, so a Grobner basis is a part of something called algebraic geometry, which is closer to pure mathematics. So that would be for those people who like math for math's sake. Okay, so if you want to go closer to math department and get a job at UC Berkeley, you'll be an algebraic geometry. Okay, its practical uses are still limited. Okay, if you go down to the bottom, common thing today is machine learning. Everybody is doing machine learning, right? It's generally not considered to be real math because it's a bit ad hoc, but it's very practical because you can quickly run some regression trees and so on and so forth and get something, somewhat useful. Okay, but along the way, there's a bunch of things. And partly as a professor, I enjoyed the variety of the mathematics. you know, and I said one advantage of being a professor is you have a lot of freedom to choose what you work on. You have to work on something, but they don't tell you what you want to work on. So it can be very theoretical some years, you can be very practical the other years, and you know, I like the, you know, in some sense, the freedom. Right, and so on the right side, I also have been a consultant and executive education for McKinsey and Company, which many of you would probably know is a very elite consulting. I consider it to be the opposite end of academics. Right, they don't think too much; they quickly send a PowerPoint, and you know, when somebody listens to this PowerPoint, they're very smart kids. They can speak very fast, and they can convince you. And from them, I learned how to speak to senior executives, and most importantly, how to price high. Because one thing I never learned as an engineer is how to price high. We're always trying to price low. We didn't tell people, I'll do it very quickly. I can do it in 2 seconds. If you can do it in 2 seconds, why will they give you $2 million? Your goal is to do it in 2 seconds, but convince somebody that it takes 2 hours. Right? That's a skill that you don't naturally get because you're trying to show off how quick you are. From McKinsey, I learned it's not how quick you are, it is how much you can charge. Okay? Then I thought, can I bring the two things together? Apply a little bit of the math, learn from McKinsey how to deal with senior executives, work with Fortune 500 company senior suites, but continue to apply the mathematics towards it. And mostly, as you can see, my early work was working with Fortune 500 company. And then since about 2000, I decided, you know, better than doing consulting for Fortune 500 companies is to have your own startup or work with other startups that may help Fortune 500 companies. Okay, so my life began here, then it jumped here, then I did some consulting here, and then I've been involved. This is a lot of healthcare work, but today I don't think I'll have much time to talk about it. Okay, that's kind of the general thing. This is the thing I read when I was in my mid-20s that opened my eyes. See, this was India in 1986 or before. Everybody wanted a government job or a safe job. Nobody was creating new jobs. It wasn't in the culture. And many of us Indians who went there were also very happy to work at IBM or work as a professor and simply said, don't fire me, give me a salary. Right? Then we started thinking, who are these people creating jobs? Who created IBM? Right? Who created John Deere? His name is John Deere. And then we start thinking, why can't you be the creator, right? And I think that is the switch that has happened in India today where people are saying, wait a minute, why should I be an employee when I can be a creator, right? But it's not new, it was 1945 issue of what, right? This was actually predicted by Schumpeter. If you haven't heard of his name, you should know. He's the guy who basically said during World War I, World War II that the world is missing the true energy of economic innovation. And the energy of economic innovation at the end is an entrepreneur, and you ask an entrepreneur why you do something, and the entrepreneur says, I do something because I just feel like it. And I think nobody has said it better than him. So here it is, right? The joy of creating, of simply getting things done, of exercising one's energy and ingenuity. You should just feel happy solving a problem previously unsolved. You should have a certain joy for simply saying, ah, I did something clever. It is an innate sense of satisfaction that drives an entrepreneur. If somebody says you can't do it, you say, ah, well, I'll get back to you. Right? Sometimes you make money, sometimes you solve a problem, sometimes you just are just happy for solving. Right? I think this is the entrepreneurial energy that I think has become unleashed now in India. That simply did not exist, I think, you know, during at least my times of your age. So my view of capitalism, the cynical view of capitalism is money goes out to make more money. There is some truth to that. But how does money go out to make more money? And I'll show you some examples. It goes out to find innovation. Why are VCs investing in you? Yes, they want to make more money. But the only way they can make more money is to invest in you. Because you are the innovator. You are the person with an idea who is willing to take some personal risk and time risk. And the rich guy is willing to take some money risk. And since he or she is going to give 20 of you, 3 of you are going to be very well off. Maybe 7 of them will fail and 10 of them are, you know, give 1x back. and the person is much happier than just investing in Sensex that's going up and down doing nothing. Right? So yes, capitalism is about money making more money, but the engine that makes more money in the long run is the investment in innovation. So to me, this article by Reisman really opened kind of the right way of saying it. Capitalism is the pursuit of newness. So the first question I ask somebody is, what is new? What is new? What are you doing that has not been done before? Tell me something new. Is it a new application domain, new algorithm, new technology platform, new business model? What are you spinning? Right? And you take that what is newness and embed it into this money system. And in current times, being good in math and computer science and engineering is probably the best thing to be in terms of getting yourself into this money system. Who started all of this? And that is why Harvard Business School is famous. What you're seeing in India in 2016 was discovered in Harvard Business School in 1930. People said, this is what we need to do. We need to find smart, young engineering type, mix them up with MBA students, create a business plan, because engineers might know how to build the product, but they don't ask the questions, how big is the market, how much does it cost, what can I price, how do I scale, what should be the organizational structure, but if you want to run a business, you have to answer those questions. Somebody has to answer those questions, right? That's why Mark Zuckerberg is the CEO and Sheryl Sandberg is the CEO, or she's MBA Harvard, right? I mean, at some point you need somebody, not just doing coding. And so these guys figured it out. And what happened as the US came out of World War II, just to give you some history, it was a disaster. The economy was a disaster. And people said, how do we get out of this? And so the first venture capital firm was created by the government called American Research and Development, ARD. And they said, we will make investments. At that time, there was no electronics engineering and computer science. So investments were in mechanical engineering and pneumatics and things of that type. Bridge it with MBAs, go to market, and make money, put the money back into this, and that's how the whole VC market began. The people who became successful said, hey, I can start my own VC company, and they created the venture capital companies that you know today, Kleiner Perkins and so on and so forth. They are the children and the grandchildren of this. And many of them, if you go back, they'll be Harvard graduates, because that is the first university that said, guys, I think there is a new game that we can play. And this game has now reached India. Okay, that's really what happened. It's about 75, 80 years old. Management science has been around for 50, 60 years. Some of you may be in the school of management. In the olden days, it was H&SS, War Department and so on. I was telling this to folks this morning. As a 10-pointer, Mekki near the top with perfect GRE scores and all that, when I applied, I had all fellowships from Purdue and places like that. I do computational fluid dynamics and CAD-CAM and 3D FEM and things of that type. And so when I told my advisor, Mr. Krishnamurti at that time, that I was going to do OR, he was so disappointed. He said, why? You're such a smart boy. Why do you want to do these girly things like OR? Real men, we do engineering. I said, no, but I like it, I'm going to do it. So I went and got my PhD over there, again, because I really liked it. But when I was getting my PhD in OR is when I discovered there's something called a business school. Because I was in Cornell engineering department, hanging out basically with OR computer science department. And then they said you need to take a minor, and you can take a minor anywhere on campus. And somebody I met said he was going to take a minor in business school. And I said, what would you do in a business school? Even I felt business school was too low for me. But then I went there and I found, wait a minute, this actually makes sense. Somebody has to build a business. So I did a minor in business. And so this is management science. So management science is applying some logical method to help, in this situation, an operating manager. But now really entrepreneurship has become front and center of most business. Right? So most of the students I teach now, maybe 20 years ago wanted to do consulting, 10 years ago wanted to do finance, today they want to do entrepreneurship. Right? So I mean, everything has a fad. I don't know what's going to come next. But, that's kind of the progress. I thought you'll enjoy it. So I'm not suggesting you do this because I don't want these professors to say, hey, we invited you to be a distinguished speaker and this is what you're telling them. But what I'm saying is, you know Mark Twain, right? He's probably the wittiest American writer of all time. You know Nikola Tesla. So Tesla was one of these engineering types with no social skills. He was mostly broke all his life. Okay, but he had this idea of something called alternating current, AC. Right? And then he was competing against Edison, who was an unusual combination of a very good engineer and a very determined organizing man. That is, he was a very organized patent producer and combined what we consider emotional skills with intellectual ability. Edison was unbelievable, not only because he was smart, but he was actually very smart streetwise, right? And so when this whole AC-DC fight was going on, there were a lot of issues. The only friend Nikola Tesla had was this Mark Twain. Mark Twain said, you know what you should do? You don't have the skills, go to Pittsburgh, there's a guy called George Westinghouse. Sell your patents to Westinghouse and tell him that you're competing against Edison. Most importantly, tell him that you're competing against J.P. Morgan. John Pierpont Morgan. Westinghouse will win. So Westinghouse wanted to beat Morgan, J.P. Morgan, and therefore we got AC current. What I'm saying is, the issue of combining intellect with money is centuries old. We may be just discovering it in this country. Okay. So my own life, I've decided, I started as a math science guy, you know, learning. And then in my 20s, 30s, I started thinking, well, maybe I should upgrade myself from just going to work every day and get myself out of what I call the labor wage earning class into a capitalist money class, right? And one way for us to do that was through entrepreneurship, right? That's how you exit this, right? You swing the bat and you hope the ball hits it, right? And once you're out, you say, okay, you know, now what can I do? So that's why the social enterprise and some charitable foundation. I support a lot of movies. Here are some books, if you guys want to read some non-technical, philosophical books to say, you know, how do rich people think? This is how they think. Okay? This is what is taught to liberal arts majors in Ivy League schools, because they are the children of very rich people, they don't have to go to work and do programming, they read stuff like that. But it gives you a sense of, you know, how the world actually operates at a high level. Spend a few minutes on SmartOps. So like many of you at different stages, I wrote a business plan. There was a competition, I competed in it, there were about 200 or 300 business plans. And it turned out that I came first. So you know, you go through round one, round two, round three, many of you might have gone through competitions like that. And then some VCs called me up, but at that time I didn't know much about VCs. So I said, I'll just take some angel funding from some folks who I'd worked with. And so some McKinsey partners and a few other people who I'd worked with said, hey, you seem to have a good idea. If you're looking for angel money, I'll give you. Okay, so I raised about $1.1 million or so in angel money. And with that, I hired about nine people, three or four engineers, two or three MBAs, some staff to say, let's build some prototypes, let's go get some, you know, first two customers. Let's prove the concept out. Let's try some revenues and see what. In about a year and a half later, I raised some VC money, about a total of $15 million, and then started building the real product. I was profitable by 2003, 2004, as I was saying, so I never raised any more money. And therefore, I had a lot of equity in the company. So usually when you sell stock to a VC, they get preferred shares, they have common stock. Preferred stock basically means that they get the money first upon exit. Sometimes they may put a hurdle rate that says I need to make at least X amount of money before you get some money, whatever, right? And so as a common stock holder, if you don't go beyond a certain valuation, you may land up with zero. That is, you don't get a proportional of the answer. So in some sense, as a entrepreneur, you want to take as little money as possible you know, so that you can exit faster. But if you take too little money, then you're undercapitalized, and then you might not get to market. So there's a little bit of art over there. But, you know, let's say $15 million to $25 million is more or less. Around 2004-2005, we created a machinery that you could repeat. So this is something else that I train a lot of entrepreneurs on, is many entrepreneurs can do the first 3 to 5 deals. Because you have the passion, you have the energy, you know yourself, you're evangelizing, you have enough friends, people like your charm, you'll get the first 3-5 deals. That doesn't concern me. What's going to happen is, how do you go from 5 to 50? How do you go from 5 to 500? Because you can't be doing the same thing again. The early adopters are gone. You can't be everywhere. You'll get sore throat, you know, you'll have no life. So at some point, you have to create a repeatable machinery. Right? That somebody who's your chela can execute, so that that guy's chela can execute, and so that at some point, you have a sales machinery that is ripping through the globe, and you are only working on the next generation of innovation and product. Right? And so it took us 3-4 years to figure it out. It took us about 3 years to build a product, and about 4th or 5th year, we said, I think we know how to get this machinery. Around 6, I became a partner, 05, I became a partner with SAP. We had a co-marketing agreement. In 09, I signed a solution extension, which meant that SAP guys could sell my product. So their thousands of sales reps would be trained. And every time they sold the product, they would get X amount of money, and I would get some money back, my royalties. And then around 2012, they said, hey, we want to buy you out. And it took us a while, and we sold the company. Okay, so just to give you a quick run. The specifics are not important. The general principles is what I'm going after. You need some funding to get going, right? It may be some angel fund. At some point, you might need some institutional money. You have to be careful not to take too little and not to take too much. And get into profitability help. And then you got to figure out a scaling model. You got to figure out how this is going to just rip through the world. Right? And that's where, you know, you have to start thinking differently from a technology. You have to think like a business. So I'll give you one example of a company that uses it. How many of you heard of a company called Celestica? We have. How many have a company called Foxconn? Celestica competes with Foxconn. They make Blackberries. So what you notice is, you know a brand name, but they are only designing and marketing. The manufacturing is being done by somebody else. Apple is manufactured by Foxconn. Blackberry is manufactured by Celestica. So what I'm saying is, I am selling to the makers, not to the designer. Just this part. It's called B2B. Okay, so many of us know B2C well because we are all consumers, we know consumer space. But trillions of dollars of economic behavior is in B2B space. So just keep that in mind. That, you know, if 1,000 people are competing in B2C and nobody's competing in B2B, maybe it's better for you to compete in B2B. This is what they make. I think they also make Xbox. Let's see BlackBerry over there, healthcare, they make. This is how that global view I gave you looks in my software. Every plant will be a box, every inventory point will be a triangle, and you say, so what does your math do? My math looks at all the possible demand fluctuations, capacity constraints, lead times, cost, blah, blah, blah. It presses a button and tells companies with billions of dollars of inventories to figure out where to keep this inventory for maximum use of their dollars of inventory. The English problem being solved is, how do you satisfy your customers with the least amount of working capital? And why does that matter? Because a company, if you're a publicly traded company, you're measured on working capital productivity, and that has a direct impact on your stock. So if you're a CFO, you're asking for your working productivity. If you are the head of supply chain and chief operating officer, you're trying to minimize cost as well as the inventory investment, which is basically a debt instrument. And if you're the CEO, you just want to make sure that while your sales guys are selling, your operating guys are using least amount of investments to make the profit. You look at the ratio of profit to investments. If that is high, Wall Street likes you. If that is low, Wall Street doesn't like you. So it's a direct translation into stock price. Okay? So I went straight to the senior executives and I said, guys, you have been investing a lot in ERP and APS systems. What if I added a third layer called EIO and I'll give you global assessment and, you know, operating away. Some of these are brands you may or may not use. Smuckers, they sell Smuckers here, jam and jelly and all that. GlaxoSmithKline, HP. So now about 100, 120 global customers with more than 10,000 products running. I'll go through quickly just to tell you what's actually happening in the world of supply chain. There is something called supply, there is demand, there is inventory. And before SmartOps, this inventory was a bit of a fuzz. And basically what I told them was, if you buy my software, I'll coordinate it across different parts of the world and I can tighten this. You'll notice in my presentation there's no math, there are no formulas. Because the higher you climb in a hierarchy of an organization, the less math you should use. Okay? So at some point, it's better to communicate very clearly what you're doing, and then they can say, okay, somebody low down in the organization, figure out is the math correct. Okay. Typically, I'll show you. This is the hookup. So I wanted multi-stage inventory planning optimization. If you're used to SAP, this is what a company would have as part of SAP. This would be my product, this would be the inputs and outputs. And so I position the product as a SAP or an Oracle add-on. Because I knew at some point I had to exit, somebody has to buy. Right? One thing that happens, if you have taken venture capital money, you are on the clock. Right? Because they need to exit. They don't care what you're doing, they just want their money back with some good multiple. And so if they are looking at IRR as their measurement, internal rate of return, if the numerator is not very high, the denominator has to be very low, which means that the time has to be fair. So if you're not showing a very good growth rate, they'll say sell, 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 means sell the company out. So that is one thing you ought to be worried about when you take VC money, is that at some point as a founder, you may be misaligned with the VC, because a founder, you have a dream. As a VC, he or she only has an IRR. Okay, as long as your dream and his IRR are in the same line, everybody's happy. The minute your dream is not going as fast as the IRR, you know, kind of all the fights begin. And it makes sense, right? Because he's a business guy, she's a business guy. If he doesn't return, then he won't get the next one, he'll get fired. So, again, it's not personal. This is how the game is played. So, a typical company would have these investments. Have you heard of a company called Aspect? This is also a CMU-based startup, was bought by I2 at the peak of internet boom for $9 billion. I think the founder is IIT Bombay guy. His brother is IIT Madras. Vadhwan is brother. So the Sunil's brother. So if you say, how come all you Indians went there and made money, this is what we would do. Right? Create software, so somebody buy it for a lot of money. So you can see different product, industries. That's the stock price move of beer. So when the CFO, talks to us, they say, hey, here's the stock price. So I said, hey, we started working with you around this time and see how the stock goes. Obviously, we were not the only thing that mattered. They were doing other things. But we were in the top three or four initiatives. And if you're a publicly traded company, every quarter you have to present to Wall Street. The CEO, the CFO, a couple of chief executives, they have to get on the phone. These things are fully videotaped or, voice taped. All the transcripts are available. Equity analysts will be asking tough questions because they have to make buy, hold, sell decisions. They have to make recommendations to pension funds and so on. I'm just showing you how capitalism works. Stock market doesn't move randomly. You and I buy stock, it has no impact. Stock market moves when institutional money comes in. Hedge fund comes and buys $120 million. Pension fund buys $400 million. Some Saudi fund drops $200 million. That's when you see stock prices. They are reacting to equity analysts. Equity analysts are writing the reports based on their own analysis and this quarterly meeting. Right? So what you have to do is to get into that quarterly meeting where the CEO, CFO is saying, hey, okay, how are we increasing our margins? We're increasing our margins through these activities. How are you getting working capital productivity? We have these initiatives going. We're going to tell you in the next 3 or 5 quarters that our working productivity will increase by 22%. This is what we are presenting to the street, and based on that, some people will believe it or not, because based on past execution, they'll give you a stock bump, or they will say, I'll wait to see one or two quarters to see whether you execute. If you execute, there's stock. All senior executives' compensation is based on stock options, so stock moves, they make money. That's the game. This is called capitalism. And so what you can do as an entrepreneur is to create a product that supports the engine of capitalism. And if you do that, then other people will invest in you because they are part of the same capitalism. So that is why I thought today's talk is, as an academic, how did I enter this world of capitalism? Because a typical academic would not enter this money cycle. Right? So here are many things. So this is about a third of my customer list. I used to joke that combined these people have given me more than $100 million. So what could be logos to you is real money. But why did they give me money? Not because they liked me. They gave me money because the product was going to make the stock price go. Right? This is also in Europe. So we have deployed a lot of things. At the end of the day, you say, why does a technology become widely used? Why do you like to use a product? The same reason anybody reason. First, the value proposition should be clear. As an entrepreneur, very clearly say, what are you doing? Within 30 seconds or less, if you can't say it, then you don't know what you're doing, then the other guy doesn't know what you're doing. The second thing is, if the value prop is clear, it should be easy to use. At some point, people don't want to have. So you focus on usability, you focus on messaging very, very clearly what's going on, right? And then you deliver, of course, that's your kind of okay, I'm going to stop on that side and move to a different topic, okay? So that's software entrepreneurship at the basic level. Today you'll build it on the cloud. I built it on a server-side browser computing, then I had to port it on the cloud, but today you'll build mobile on the cloud, but you'll probably run through the same. It takes some angel money and